Today on Anatomy of a Movie, we talk about Alice Through the Looking Glass, the fun sequel to Alice in Wonderland. Stay tuned.
Welcome to Popcorn Talk, featuring movie discussion, news, and interviews. Popcorn Talk, we talk movies. And now, here's Popcorn Talk's Anatomy of a Movie.
That's right, everybody. Hello. Welcome back to Anatomy of a Movie on the Popcorn Talk Network. Today we are talking about the fun James Bobin film, Alice Through the Looking Glass, the fun sequel to the 2010 Tim Burton's Alice in Wonderland. I'm your host, Marisa Serafini. You can follow me on Twitter at SerafiniTV, and you can follow my co-host,
D Movies.
Hey, Marisa, it's Demetri. Hello, movie fans. How are you?
Hello, Demetri.
And I'm Phil Svitek.
Hi, Phil.
Hello, all.
Yes, hello, everybody. Alice Through the Looking Glass. Real quick thoughts of your quick thoughts on this film. Phil, how about we start with you?
I've never been an Alice in Wonderland type of guy. Most of my references come to it through other things. Like, it's just always constantly referencing something, you know, and always the Mad Hatter and this and that. So it's kind of become this iconic thing. And, for me, this movie in particular, I thought it was fun. It worked. But overall, I don't necessarily know if I was the right audience for it. But I can't say it's a bad movie. You know, it just wasn't my cup of tea. I would not show up at the Mad Hatters. Right. Certainly not on time. So
I'll follow that white rabbit down the rabbit hole.
Yeah, you know. And I'll also preface it. I did not read the books either. So, sure. You know, it's beyond my mythos.
Okay. Gotcha. Demetri?
You know, well, I just got to say thank you, movie critics of the world, because prior to going into this, you know, I'd seen very many bad reviews. Like, you just see the headlines. And, again, always referencing 30% on Rotten Tomatoes. So my bar was set a little bit low. I was a modest fan of the Tim Burton's Alice in Wonderland. Not huge, but modest. So going into this, I was like, all right, what are they going to throw at me? And you know what? I have to say, I found this movie to be very entertaining and enjoyable. And I think I might have even liked it more than the original or Tim Burton's version. Mia
Wasikowska,
whom I love, she was great. And she showcases the ability to carry a movie in the supporting cast, including newbie to the series, Sacha Baron Cohen, I thought was very good. Seriously, not a movie as bad as many portray it to be, in my opinion. Sometimes, I honestly think this, sometimes I really do think that people forget and critics forget what a bad movie is. I didn't think that it warranted its 30%.
Yeah, I agree with you, Demetri. Before we came on air for this one, I admit I enjoyed the second one, this film, a little bit more than I did the first one. Because I remember watching the first one, walking out, and thinking I didn't love it. It was fun, especially back, you know, it just shows just how much Hollywood industry has changed in 6 years and how we view movies back from 2010 to now. I think Tim Burton did a great job of creating a world of yes. Alice. And I think this film, did better in storytelling. Like, Tim Burton, he's very creative visually. And I think this one did better story and thematically compared to... I mean, we did have some great visuals in this film, too. And it was fun. But I did actually thoroughly enjoy this one more so. And maybe because I have matured over the last 6 years, and how I watch movies is so much different than how I did 6 years ago. And I have a greater appreciation for Alice Through the Looking Glass and just the stories of Alice in Wonderland and Lewis Carroll. I didn't really appreciate just the stories as a kid because it was kind of way over my head and I didn't understand it. And now being more of an adult, and then I appreciated it more in my younger adults. Teenage life mm-hmm. to adult now.
I think this one, I mean, in terms of for women, she's a lot stronger to me in this movie. And just because of this, obviously she kind of goes off of that arc from the first one into this one. And, you know, just by that nature of it, she's already a stronger person to begin with. And now, you know, we're coming into it 3 years after the fact. She's on these boats.
Ship captain.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I really liked that because it showed just how much her character has grown too. And then, like, she has literally stepped into a leadership role, and she became a stronger person authority-wise and how people just view her in that society.
Yeah.
So did you feel the same way?
Yeah, well, first off, bully for you for maturing these past 6 years, because I have not, as people tend to tell me. But no, I really felt that, you know, Alice in Wonderland, that movie was a great setup because you did have a... You had a strong female character who was going on this... It was a journey of enlightenment for her and finding her own way and becoming that strong character. And I thought her segueing into the role... I really love the opening of this movie with her. First off, it was a great reveal because she's on the ship, and then you realize, wait, she's barking out orders. She's the captain of this. Like, wow, that's fantastic. Like, that's great, especially if you want to throw it into that time period where that would never really happen. But I think just for movie-going audiences, for little girls alike, she's captain of a ship, and she's getting out of this. She's escaping pirates. How exciting is that? So, yeah, I thought that what they did just from that get-go, I found that to be fascinating. And then I was like, well, this is a fascinating story. How are we going to bring her back into the world of Wonderland? Like, how are they going to take her out of this prominent role, and what is she going to have to do in Wonderland? You know, I do find that this movie, too, I think, and we can get more of it in reaction, but it was sort of trippy. You know, it was a little bit, you know, I hate to use the word convoluted, but there's lots going on. You had to pay attention to this movie. But that was one of the aspects that I enjoyed. I enjoyed the time travel element.
Yeah, I mean, well, anytime you introduce time travel, you got to figure out your own set of rules. Otherwise, even with your own set of rules, it starts to get, whoa, what's going on?
Absolutely. And, you know, they stuck to some of the tropes. They broke some of the tropes as well, made their own set of rules. But I thought the concept and how it was portrayed, not only through research, not only were things very English and British, but I liked how it was portrayed, and to me it was an homage of that great H.G. Wells, The Time Machine. And the thing that she wrote in reminded me very much of H.G. Wells's Time Machine thing and going through the seas of time. I thought that was a great representation. So much fun to watch.
Yes. Phil, did you like the character growth of Alice?
Yeah. Again, I think for her... You know, absolutely. You know, and I thought what was fun in this one, because I thought overall she was always, you know, I don't think she arced as much. Like, the first one really was about Alice. I think this, it was fun to see the different characters and how they're sort of arcing throughout this whole bit.
Yeah.
And the changes that they have of perspective and, you know, the different types of realities we go through.
And I also like, too, how we learn about our characters. Like, so, this was a sequel, but outside of Alice, we're learning more of the past of, like, the Red Queen and things like that, and her sister. And I sort of kind of liked that, using that time travel concept about, you know, the whole, well, how does she become to get to who she is today, of what we know her as? And I thought it was very cleverly done. They set up a good... story about the lie, you know, things like that. I appreciated that. Getting backstory.
I mean, you know, let's get into some of the writing. Obviously, Linda Wolverton, who's back again. You know, she's done a lot of Disney films from, you know, she did the first Alice in Wonderland. She did Maleficent 1 and the new upcoming 2 and then Lion King's 1 and 2 and the new Beauty and the Beast movies. So she's very well established in the Disney writing in that sense. And she said, I look for a relatable theme, and then I apply the characters and the things that I want to explore with regard to the relationships or a certain character, and that's kind of where I go from. So going off of, like, building characters that she's already established and whatnot. But for the writing, I did like for the sequel that we did learn more about other characters who were quickly established in the first one.
Right.
But to learn more about the sisters, the Red Queen and the White Queen, like, I liked... this, because it is a big movie and there's a lot, it's kind of an ensemble cast.
Yeah.
But they did spend a good, well-balanced enough time of these two sisters. Yeah. And I have more understanding of where they're coming from and why they are the way they are.
Yeah. And Helena Bonham Carter. I mean, she's just loving this role, right? I mean,
so good.
She's just so much fun to watch. And, you know, when you place her opposite of Anne Hathaway as well, who I actually liked Anne Hathaway better in this movie too, even more so than the first Alice, you really did see a chemistry between the two. And I enjoyed the resolution that those characters had at the end. But watching Helena Bonham Carter, you know, she's just great. She's so fun to watch.
Phil, what were your favorite things about the sister dynamic storyline?
Again, it's kind of what you guys said. It's seeing them at a younger age, right? You know, it's one thing to come into it and, you know, in the first one, seeing the conflict and kind of having to deal with it, whereas... Yeah, it's always fun when you get kind of the reason as to why people are the way they are, and how that can shift. And they're great actresses, you know. I think Helena, going back to Beatrix, Anne Hathaway is just she's a great character actor, you know. And I think she just always manages to pull it off, and she's fun. Although I have not seen The Princess Diaries, right? Is that what it's called? Yes,
The Princess Diaries.
I always get
that. And they're coming out with a third one. Very excited for that, too.
Yes, very excited myself for that one as well.
You can guess who will be covering that one.
I thought, again, it's in a way, what I like is these characters, in a way, to me, always have represented Alice. Mm-hmm. You know, and they're kind of a reflection of her and little... bits and pieces. Like, that's why Humpty, like, when he breaks apart, it's like, you know, all these characters to me are little bits of broken Alice.
The horse and men going after him.
Oh, it was great.
I liked it. I agree with you there, Phil. I liked the fact that it kind of switched my mentality of the Red Queen and the White Queen.
Yeah.
Because we're so conditioned for the audience that we're supposed to dislike the Red Queen and love the White Queen. But, like, knowing their past a little bit, like, oh, the White Queen isn't as good and as pure as we're led to believe, or we should know.
Right.
And that we should feel more for the Red Queen because she was done wrong, and the White Queen was the one doing the wrongdoing. And it switched my thoughts on them. I was like, wow, for once I like the Red Queen, and for once I don't like the White.
You understand the motivations of the Red Queen as, I mean, off of their heads. Yeah. She takes it to an extreme. And again, as played by Helena Bonham Carter, it's a wonderful, nutty extreme. But, you know, at least there is the motivation. You see what happened as the childhood goes. That's why I really thought that the resolution at the end was sweet and touching. And it worked. It felt earned when it happened. I think we do have to talk about, like, the character that they brought in that was not from Alice in Wonderland, because pretty much everybody, you know, they got everybody back. Everybody from Johnny Depp, Helena Bonham Carter, Anne Hathaway, they got everybody back. And they had to add a new character, who was Sacha Baron Cohen.
Time.
And he was Time. And I found it very interesting that the director decided to personify Time, because apparently the Alice in Through the Looking Glass, the book, is very purposely non-cohesive. Mm-hmm. And it does deal with time. However, the director right now, James Bobbin, who's British, English, one of the reasons he took the job is Lewis Carroll is so entrenched into English mythology and myth and pop culture, you had to read Lewis Carroll. It's part of growing up. It's a rite of passage. And he even admits that the second book is very trippy. It's like purposely incoherent the way that it's written. But he believed that Lewis Carroll wrote Time as being a person. And he even went on and he said, you know, if you look at Alice in Wonderland book, Alice first meets the Hatter when he's frozen in a moment at his tea party. And he says to her, I've been stuck at this tea party since last March when Time and I quarreled. And to the Hatter, Time is a person. Lewis Carroll wrote him as a person. Hiring Sacha Baron Cohen to play this person So we see time personified. I thought that was a stroke of genius. You make time, you make something that is either, like, you can see time pass, but it's relatable, and you give them a, this function.
And the good news is the notion's not, you know, while it's a stroke of genius, it's also not something we're not unused to, right? I mean, you know, father time. But the good news is, again, rather, you know, father time can also be like the all-knowing sort of person, old and wise, whereas with Sacha Cohen Baron, you know, and he's not being Borat here or Ali G, which obviously they've worked together on, but he's being, you know, he's being respectful and comedic for what the role required him of. And yeah, it is a different portrayal of time in the sense that he's just nutty and it works rather than the... that wisdom and that stoicness that you would think.
He's not all-knowing.
No, yeah, not at all.
Not, he's not all-knowing.
Although
at all.
He is witty when she comes out, you know, like, hey, can I have a moment of your time? Well, that would mean you need a piece of me.
Right.
Yeah.
So, no.
I like the physical
portrayal.
And I
like that banter.
Yeah. I think Sacha Baron Cohen did a great job portraying a new kind of character, but yet familiar, and I liked how they gave him humanistic characters for the audience to understand a little bit better.
Yeah, it totally fits in that realm. Universe, right?
Yes.
That realm.
It definitely, but I like the idea of the time's chronosphere.
Yes.
Because I think that was an excellent device that also visually and storytelling-wise moved the story forward.
Yeah.
And kept it going, because there was
It's your little DeLorean.
Exactly.
Yeah, you know
it
what
really
I mean?
Was.
Like, you needed it.
It really was. And then, I mean, we'll get to it, but the whole, like, literally running out of time, so, like, the movie itself had a timetable to work off of, and that kept the pace of the movie going too, just the whole idea of time's running out, so we got to keep moving forward.
Right. And again, something else that Bobbin refers to is that whole what do they call that again, the timepiece, the
chronosphere.
Okay, very English for your characters to go to time and ask permission. Excuse me, sir. May I please have? Can I borrow your chronosphere for? And like, and he said that that's one aspect that he really wanted to embrace in this movie, is he wanted it to be very keyed into England, and you know, and there's nothing more England than requesting permission to use a chronosphere and going to time himself to do it.
Well, the interesting part, I don't know. To me, you can look at that as British, but again, I just look at it as a, you know, Alice has this tale of morals and things like that and whatnot. And I don't know. To me, that's just good manners. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
so
I get it. I get it.
F the Brits for thinking they own manners.
No.
Because America, you know, we just steal that.
We just
take it.
But no, I mean, I get what you're saying, but in the context of, like, you got to be very proper. Mm-hmm. And I found that very interesting that we had two characters who needed to go to time to ask for permission. And, you know, we had the Red Queen, who more or less wanted to demand the time, you know, and yet Alice, who in fact had to take time into her own hands.
Literally. To the point where she does take it.
The chronosphere was great, though. And like you said, it was like a DeLorean.
I think it was a really cool aspect. And I think also just how they traveled through time and how they used an ocean. Because there is actually a line, and this is where the visual effects and the writers thought of going through the oceans of time as their way of traveling, rather than just like flashbacks or whatnot, that they wanted to actually travel. Because there's a line in the actual Alice Through the Looking Glass travels through the oceans of time.
Yeah, you know, in terms of the chronosphere too, in terms of actually separating, because I did joke about it being DeLorean, and what's nice is that it is, but it's also a relic that, you know, everyone's after. Was the DeLorean, no one is actively seeking to
except
get the
for Biff.
In the second, yeah, it's a little, but once he's done with it, he's done with it.
Right.
You know, whereas the fact that it compresses itself into a, you know, literal thing that you can carry.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Was a good distinction and worked well.
Yeah, I thought so too. But and again, just going back to an English reference, and again, I couldn't find anything that will support my theory. But if you'd ever read H.G. Wells' Time Machine or saw the movie, not the Guy Pearce movie, although he still has this round thing, it is relatively representative of what H.G. Wells' time machine uses. You know, it's got the levers, the date thing pops up. It's very, in a sense, almost steampunkish. It was a really great. It was a great representation for her to jump into. And again, it was great because when she would land, she could land, it would fold up and she could tumble and pick it up, put it away. It was a great
roll
effect.
It like a dice, you know, yeah. and it would disappear.
It was cool. It was a very great representation.
I think it was a really fun, just neat device that I could totally see as a marketing toy.
Yeah.
For the kids.
Sure.
Like they could play with a little version of a Chronosphere. That'd Absolutely. Be fun. Let's talk about another story that I think was pretty well written into this film, the Mad Hatter's family and his whole backstory in that sense. Learning kind of where Mad Hatter came from, being a kid, and he always wanted to build little hats for his father to get his approval. And I think, okay, that I get the understanding of why he loves hats so much.
Right.
This was the part, like, if there's one character that I probably didn't ever want to explain, it's probably the Mad Hatter, only because there's just such an air of intrigue to him, you know, and even as iconic as Alice in Wonderland is, I feel like everyone just knows the Mad Hatter in all of sort of popular culture, right? Mm-hmm. So that was for me one of the points where, you know, I appreciate the storyline. I thought it worked really well. But again, I just, in a way, I want him to be his mysterious self that I don't know much about besides just being crazy.
Interesting. Okay. Because I appreciated at least of his family that we meet in this movie. Obviously, the Mad Hatter is the most rebellious one. He's the one that, like, he's the most flamboyant. He's the most colorful on purpose, where his family, you know, not so much. But you understand that even with this rebelliousness side or this flamboyant side, that, you know, he has deep respect and love for his parents. I got, like, when he realizes that his family is still alive, and that puts him in that funk, so to speak. You know, I did find it interesting. To your point, Phil, like, yes, had we gone on, like, did we need to know Hatter background? Does the mystery of who he is within the world of Alice in Wonderland, like, keeping it a mystery could be a good idea? I just think when they set out to write this story, you know, I think it fits. It didn't bother me that we learn a little bit about Hatter, because we're learning about the White Queen and the Red Queen and their family backgrounds. We know about Alice enough. I did like the framework. I like the bookends as to, you know, Alice was to be betrothed, we know, from the first Alice in Wonderland. She thumbs her nose up to this, you know, and this guy's trying to get her back. And again, put women in her place. She's going to be a secretary, you know, and Alice has other ideas. See, that to me, I mean, I love that whole notion. And we learn more about Alice and her relationship to her mom and things like that. So this really was a family affair, if you think about it.
Yeah, definitely. We got a lot of family stories. What I liked about the Mad Hatter's family, that it kind of explained another reason why the Mad Hatter's happy and colorful. Because the idea that he didn't know where his family was, he thought, you know, he thought the worst, and he thought they were dead and whatnot. It took away, literally took away his color and personality. And I think that kind of added to the fact that, like, okay, because of his family is the reason why he is the person who he is.
True.
And you take that away, he's not that person. Yeah. So I liked how that helped with character development and understanding of where the Mad Hatter comes from. I think it was really well done, and it wasn't too, you know, too spread out throughout the whole film. It was well explained that I could understand it.
Right.
So I think they were very, very strong stories. Again, the storytelling, I think, was better and more concise in this film.
I think, you know, but it's funny you say concise, and you mentioned DeLorean, so, you know, I have to bring it back to the future, because while I believe the Back to the Future trilogy is one of the, you know, greatest trilogies, it stands up there with just a few other trilogies, but Back to the Future is a very strong trilogy, great through line. A lot of people were somewhat turned off in Back to the Future 2. I love Back to the Future 2, but many people found that to be convoluted, because you had to follow these timelines going through, and they found it hard to follow at times.
Watch the first one, you need to understand.
But the first one, you have one time.
And they're going forward, they're going back, and you know they explain everything. I think Alice Through the Looking Glass is a Back to the Future too, because we are going back. We're trying to run away from time. We have this time machine, and it does, in a sense, if you're not paying close attention, you know, you might get a little confused. Like, where are we? What's going on here? Now, I'm not saying Alice Through the Looking Glass is as good as Back to the Future 2. Not at all. I'm just saying that was my only comparison that I could come up with. Because everybody loves to compare things. Mm-hmm. So, and that to me, you know, could have been, and when we get to talk about gross and things, you know, box office, you know, I was just wondering who this movie was made for. Because clearly, the Alice in Wonderland was made for a particular audience, and it really succeeded in those box office grosses, where this one, I'm not sure that same audience is going to really try to make heads or tails out of exactly what's going on, the concept of time and all that, but like, I enjoyed it.
Yeah, like which story would appeal to which demographic more?
Exactly. I mean, you know, I think the tough part is with the first one, right? Marissa's saying that visually it's, you know, it worked better visually than it did story-wise. I thought, you know, with a movie like that, you know, and it's good that Tim Burton did do that one, because the visuals do need to work, right? Mm-hmm. Alice in Wonderland is nothing if not visual. And I'm sure so many people went just to see the visuals of that. Let alone, like, I'm sure they could care less about the story.
Even the animated Disney version.
Oh, yeah. Phenomenal.
Absolutely. And, you know, so I think, yeah, I mean, in terms of how do you step it up? Well, obviously you need to, in this one now, you have a base of what the visuals of the original were, right. So you don't have to necessarily worry as much about that because you know the direction you have to go in. And, yeah, now, okay, how do you elevate it? Well, we got to add some story.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, so I do think there's that distinction, you know, and I thought it, as a movie, it progressed nicely from one to the other. But yeah, I mean, I don't know. It's always tough for me to think of, like, because it's a PG movie, right? So it's, you know, the rating dictates that it's kids. But I don't know. It's tough for me to remember what it was like to see a movie like this at whatever age, 7, 8,
right?
And whether or not I would understand or confuse. But the nice part, it's got enough vignettes where, like, you can enjoy, like, whether or not you understand the movie, you can enjoy certain portions of it.
Yeah, I think maybe the general audience that's going to see that is a group families or friends that are together who can enjoy this as a whole rather individually. Yeah. I mean, I went individually, but I still enjoyed it.
Yeah. So, you know, I want to talk, because we talked about Red Queen, we're talking about time and such, and again, James Bobbin has this, I like his insight where he talks about why they made time. Because we already talked about that, he's not the all-knowing time that we've come to love and adore. He's a little off, but you know, his thing is Red Queen is already such a fantastic villain. He goes, I didn't want to create another one. Mm-hmm. He goes, so I decided to make time a twit, and then instantly knew Sasha would be perfect. Now, I love this because usually in sequels, sometimes they try to make a villain to out-villain another villain, and they didn't even attempt to do that in this. Like, that's let's true. Not make time the villain. Time isn't so much like the villain. It's a character. It's a character which everything hinges upon. But time's really not the villain here in a sense. It's you know, maybe, you know, but the Red Queen, she's still like off with their head. Like, she was just like great, and you don't want to upstage what you already have is a good. I like that approach.
Anyone have whether or not he made up a lot of that stuff, or was it like, let's see here, who's gonna tick their last talk? Who's gonna took their last tick? Like, who? You know what I mean? Whether it was the writing or he came up with that on his own, I thought that was genius.
Yeah. And again, I think he's just the kind of person that could pull it off. I think Sacha Baron Cohen is actually as close as we have towards like a Peter Sellers in his day. I think like okay. he's that kind of a comedic genius, chameleon type of actor character.
Yeah. So yeah. He's certainly up there.
Yeah.
I agree. It's like I did like this portrayal of time from Sasha. I think he did a great job. It kind of I put him up there with his Hugo character.
Yeah, he's great.
Because
yeah,
it felt like the same kind of vibe. Like his character, he was what the security guard person in Hugo, mm-hmm. and we weren't sure if we should be afraid of him or not. Yeah. But in the end, he ended actually up being a good person.
Right.
So and I think it was the same vein. Like we weren't. Sure if he was going to be a villain, but he ended up just being a character yeah. that we liked.
Yeah.
And I think that was just great on Sasha's part.
Yeah. There was another great line towards the end that he had. I will never forget you. I never want to see you again.
Yes.
Like, get out. It was great. It was the way it was delivered was perfect.
You came into my home and almost literally destroyed time. Yep. So go away. Let's get into the actors because sure. we mentioned that we did fortunately get basically everybody back.
Except for Christopher Lee.
Christopher Lee, unfortunately. Late Christopher Lee. hats off to him. Let's get into Johnny Depp. I mean, character actor himself. He's fantastic, and I liked his portrayal of Mad Hatter. And we again learning more about his character. But what did you think of his performance in this one?
You know, I enjoy watching Johnny Depp in almost anything. I think he's a very talented actor. And, you know, people have been criticizing him a lot lately for roles that he's had, whether it be he's too much Jack Sparrow and then he takes a Mordecai. But then you watch him in Black Mass and you remember why we originally fell in love with this guy, because he's a good actor. Look at him in Ed Wood. Look at him in Edward Scissorhands. Look at him in the Tim Burton movies. He's a solid actor. I wasn't a big fan of his portrayal in Alice in Wonderland. I'll be honest. I thought for me it detracted a lot from everything else that's going on. I thought his performance here, he seemed to almost rein it in a little, and I liked him better in Through the Looking Glass than I did. And Alice, I think he did. You know, I think he did it. You know, he did a decent job.
Zach from the booth says, "Look at him in Tusk."
Tusk.
Yeah.
Okay. Here's what I, you know, I don't know. I thought he did good for the role, but I've never. I will admit, I've never fully understood Johnny Depp.
Hmm.
I don't know. Mm-hmm. He's just everyone's. I just don't get him. I don't know. I've never like. Understood him in movies in general. It's a weird thing, I know, but I just never understood the fascination with Johnny Depp. I'm sorry.
No, I hear you too, because like I grew up with girls who like loved, obsessed with Johnny Depp. I'm like, he's a great actor, but that's, I mean, I appreciate he's very talented in that way, but they're the fascination.
But there. I thought he's just, the roles he portrays are this kind of like, usually, like, you know, he plays like a kooky character, whether it's Willy Wonka or you know, Edward Scissorhands. Like he plays these oddball characters, and that to me is what makes it stand out rather than his acting. Like it's just a great character.
Well, you know, I mean, I'll just go back. I'm going to try to throw the good in with the bad. I mean, when we talk about, geez, I don't know if people remember or they seem to forget what a bad movie is. He was in one such bad movie that we dissected here. It was one of the most Transcendence, which made me very angry. And he was in that. And again, not a good movie. But when you look at things like Public Enemies, he was John Dillinger. I thought he was very good. Sweeney Todd, I thought he was fantastic. Great. He did his own singing. Of course, we already know him as Jack Sparrow. He was good in Finding Neverland. I'm just going... The Secret Window, mm-hmm. Once Upon a Time in Mexico, I found him to be good. I'm just, like, again, good. From Hell. From Hell is a really good gothic. I don't want to call it a horror movie, but he's so good in that.
What about Lone Ranger right there?
Well, that goes under the sort of kind of made me angry kind of movies. Listen, but when you do Chocolat, he was Chocolat really good in that movie. When you look at what this guy's... Like
his repertoire.
Body of work. Mm-hmm. Like you're going in when you do so many movies, you're gonna have a handful that just stink. That's it. I mean, the law of averages. It just stinks. So I enjoy watching him. Again, Don Juan DeMarco, he was fantastic. Mm-hmm. Ed Wood, you got to love him there. What's Eating Gilbert Grape? I mean, the guy has done a bunch of really solid film where he wasn't necessarily even playing just the weird guy. And he's just had staying power. For, you know, he's had a run. I mean, he's hitting a bit of a lull or a speed bump, let's just say. I mean, I thought Black Mass was gonna sort of kind of bring him back to the Johnny Depp that people really enjoyed. I mean, it was Oscar worthy, I thought, a performance that he didn't get nominated for, but it's a solid performance.
This goes back to more box office, but it ties in closely more to Johnny Depp. That people are saying now's not a good time to be Johnny Depp, right? So between what Amber's saying about him in the press in terms of women abuse, right? That's it's at a bad time that they're hanging their hat on your lead is Johnny Depp.
Yeah.
It's just shitty.
But the only thing that I will say, my only counter that, and I'm not into tabloid and whatnot, and I don't want to take it.
But unfortunately, people are.
I get it. I think it happened way too, like, it literally coincided with opening, like, date, like when that movie opened. Like, if you're going to, I mean, that's a lot of, you're putting a lot of emphasis on something that, had it been a week before, I think it really could have been more devastating. It happened the week of. I'm not sure that, like, whatever impact his personal life, you know, may have taken that crazy turn, I'm not sure how much it impacted that opening weekend gross. Maybe on down the line, maybe it will affect, depending on how this all comes out, you know, it could affect the Pirates gross. Who knows? I mean, I honestly don't know. It's a terrible situation. He's not having a good run right now. And on top of, you know, going through a divorce, being accused of having a restraining order put on him, you know, he also lost his mom too. I'm not saying that this is a reason, but this is just one other thing that's been going on in his life that, you know, he's not having a good run right now. And will he overcome it?
That doesn't affect his acting whatsoever.
You would hope it doesn't affect his acting, but you just don't know how, like, whether people can weather that storm. Take, for example, like an Arnold Schwarzenegger. I don't think he ever has gotten...
Got out of Terminator?
Well, he never was able to come back after the scandal, what he did to Maria Shriver. Mm-hmm. Like, what was going on. There are some scandals that people will forget about, like whether you're drug... Like, look at Robert Downey Jr., but I think the ramifications are yet to be unseen as to what happens with Johnny Depp. And let's face it, his speed bump happened well before this. I mean, when you're in movies like The Lone Ranger, when you're in movies like Mordecai, I mean, you're just in flat-out bombs and stinkers that people avoided. So his box office power has diminished well before the Amber Heard drama has unfolded. So...
Fair enough.
All right, let's talk about Mia, Alice. I mean, Demetri, you and I, we talked in length about her during our Crimson
Peak
dissection, but I think she did a really great job as Alice in this film. And I think she's a very talented actress, and I want to see more from her because she's only had, like, a few handful of movies that are fairly memorable at this point. But I think she did such a great job in these films that can easily open doors for more awesome roles for her.
There's enough of a period of time where it's very admirable how she was able to come back to that character, right? Because it's not like a sequel that happened right away, and it's easier to get back into character. Mm-hmm. You know, there's that portion to the, you know, whether it's Crimson Peak or anything else, that there's been this length of time where she had to get in the mindset of other characters.
Right.
So, and especially for something like that, like Crimson Peak, that's a
gothic horror
that's
movie.
That's a serious movie.
Yeah, and what I felt she proved in that movie is that she can carry a movie, and she can stand toe-to-toe with very talented supporting characters and actors. Mm-hmm. I think she's a very gifted, talented actress that I want to see more from. They should utilize her, especially when we're talking about trying to find new actresses and getting them jobs and getting them in Hollywood. Build strong roles for a woman. I think Alice is a strong role for her. And you're right, to a point, you know, I mean, it took a little while for the sequel to get off the ground, so it is sort of, it's somewhat miraculous, because you would figure that these people have other things in sight. So she came back to reprise this role. Money, I'm sure, had something to do with it, but also I think she liked the character. I think in the way that it was written, I found her to be a stronger character in this movie than the first one.
Because she is a stronger character, and they wrote more for her. And what I liked about her character is because she has matured so much. And I mean, even when she was, you know, she was a captain, and then when she got reintegrated back into her regular society, she stood out. And I think that was also on purpose, because just her wardrobe, she was so colorful.
Right.
Especially when they were in that ballroom scene, whatever. She obviously stood out amongst everyone. She was a sore thumb, and she didn't belong there. She didn't belong with her so-called regular society.
Right.
But she belonged more in Wonderland.
Yeah.
But I like that, because it just showed that this is a character who's grown so much.
And it was also a character, though, as much as she had grown and become strong, she was a character that still could get things wrong. You know, she even realized, and that I think is part of the, I think what was part of the good storytelling in this is that even though she's ship's captain and she's this strong woman, she is not necessarily making the right decisions in Wonderland, and even to a point where she apologizes to Tom. She goes, "I'm sorry." She goes, "You were right. I didn't see it. I didn't believe it. You know, people were trying to tell me. I wasn't listening. You know, I could have, you know, maybe gone about it a different way." But she apologizes, and that to me too is growth in character in a very good way. So, yeah, yes. And she was great, and she can carry that kind of a movie. I believed her as a ship's captain. You know, when she was up there and she's cutting the sails, I go, I'm down. I'm here. Yeah.
And it showed the audience that she's capable. She's the kind of character who will literally go the extra mile to do something, to get something right, or get something done.
Absolutely.
And I was like, yes, I can immediately get on board, literally, with Ellis. So let's talk about a little bit about Helena Bonham Carter.
Sure.
She's fantastic as well. Again, love the growth of the Red Queen. And she said, Helena said in an interview on the first film, she talked to the writer, Linda Wolverton, that they were just talking about what caused the Red Queen to lose her way. And they came up with the decision that it was a tumor in her brain, but they never specified the specifics of the accident. So that was from the first film that they were talking about. So right. I liked how they actually fleshed that out in the second film to explain, she hit her head, and that's why her head's so swollen and big.
Yeah.
But I think Helena is just great to come back to this type of over-the-top character.
And she doesn't let the clothes and the costume and the makeup overpower her performance. I mean, her costume acts as well, but the little heart and the lips, and it's just the way that her inflection, the way she talks. Yeah, she's just great. She's like this, you know, I love hearing her say, "Off with our heads." And like sometimes she says it for no reason, and then she's like, it's like she's so used to saying it. It's like you can picture her waking up from a dream saying, "Off with their heads," for no reason. You know, her costume, according to Colleen Atwood, or to the producer, I should say, the most expensive costume was the new Red Queen armor that she had to wear, apparently. But all of those costumes, I'm going to say, are more expensive than you think. Colleen Atwood, she won the Oscar for Alice.
She did.
You know, which is pretty incredible. Coming back and again, when you get that type of caliber and they're going to come back for a sequel, number one, I think it's great for through line continuity, someone who already knows the characters, but I think that what she did with the Hatter stuff is great. There's a new version of Hatter that we call Safari Hatter, you know. And I like that there's some creative juices in coming up and making these characters still look fresh to us and not just the same. So
yes, Phil, do you feel the same way?
About the costuming?
About Helena.
Yeah, no, I thought, again, I've enjoyed her as an actress, and, you know, seeing her in this crazy role, you know, as much fun as the Mad Hatter is, I think she actually sometimes, you know, does better than him, right? Just in terms of the sheer volume of madness.
Yeah.
And the fact that she can carry that, because, again, everything's so, you know, especially with the first one, is so put on, like, oh, Johnny Depp.
Right.
You know, and, the you know, again, I think she manages to steal that mantle from him, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. I liked the character of Red Queen in this film, because even, like, her first appearance back into this, the first thing we see of her is her shadow.
Right.
And so just her shadow having a bigger presence than what her character, I mean, her character is obviously big, but, like, she establishes such a presence that we should be afraid immediately just at the sound and at the look of her shadow, let alone the character herself.
Yeah.
I think just shows how great of a job she established her character in the first one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So. And I found it very funny of the hint of romance between Time and the Red Queen. I thought that was hysterical. And of course, you know, would you expect anything less than her to be demanding and not shutting up and always getting what she wants to get, you know, including the Chronosphere? You know, again, I thought that rapport was very funny.
Yeah.
Very funny. She's great.
Yeah, another great person, Anne Hathaway. Love her. She's fantastic as Marana, the White Queen. I think she did a great job. And, you know, just I learned actually more about the White Queen in the interviews from Anne Hathaway than...
Really?
And we saw a lot of backstory, too. But, like, how Anne approached her character with this, that even from her costumes, Anne said the first look at her costumes of the White Queen was that the thing that she thought was air. So that's...
She pretty much wore the same dress. Didn't get any upgrades. Do the work for her. Do their duty work for her.
Her diligence.
I don't know if that's Buddhist either. Just absolutely. But
You know, I've gained respect for for Anne Hathaway these past these past few years. I mean, she's a fine actress and all, but amidst all this throwing roles to younger actresses and such. You know, she was asked, like, how she felt about this, and her response was, and I paraphrase because I don't have the direct quote, she said something to the effect of, well, you know, I'm losing parts. Like, you know, like, they're hiring people to play 30-year-olds, and they're hiring people in their early 20s to play older characters. She goes, I get it because that was me 10 years ago. I was getting roles that other people weren't getting, and I was much younger than the role that was being portrayed, that I had to portray. I like that because it's a sense of self-interest. I'm happy that I appreciate in characters who are more in line with my age to much younger people, but that was me 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. She goes, I get it. I'm just hoping that, you know, she is a very talented actress. She's you know, I don't want her to lose out. And again, when you talk about finding strong-willed women, or strong roles, I should say, strong roles for women, you know, there's another actress that we have that just because of age shouldn't preclude people from choosing that person to be in a role.
Yeah, and I think the great thing about Anne is that, like, the films that she does pick to do, that whether she acts or voice acts and whatnot, she has a very wide demographic.
Absolutely.
Very wide. I mean, she does Disney films, which appeals to the kids' movies. And I mean, and she did the Rio movies, which also appealed to kids. And then, like, she does serious movies like Brokeback Mountain and Les Mis and Havoc and whatnot, which is a completely different demographic. So, like, her, I think that's a testament to her acting and her range.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So
no, like, no matter if you're a young female or just a viewer in general, there's, like, so many people can watch her films.
Yeah.
But, all right, let's talk a little bit about Alan Rickman, the late Alan Rickman, unfortunately.
Absolutely.
This film was dedicated to him, our good friend Alan Rickman, which for the short amount of time the Caterpillar was on screen, he has such a noticeable voice.
Absolutely.
And you're like, oh, man, Alan. I liked it, and I liked how they kept him in this film.
Yeah, I wished, you know, you'd wish for more.
Yeah.
I mean, the caterpillar was more, it was much more in Alice. I'm lucky that they were able to cultivate what they had, so to have them in there. But
I thought they utilized them quite well, and it's almost, it's poetic that he's now a butterfly in the movie.
Right.
You know what mm-hmm. I mean? In some sort of strange way, if you kind of look at this, whatever the evolution symbolism, evolution. Yeah, you know, sure. I thought, you know, where we knew him as one thing, and now he's just right. different.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree. I agree.
It is just unfortunate that he has passed, but I did love the fact that, you know, he's still such a well-known actor.
Sure.
And well-respected actor, to the fact that they could dedicate this film for him.
Yeah. Yeah, and he's an actor, too, that completely transcended. I mean, he completely transcended his Hans Gruber. I mean, an amazing villain. Okay. Yeah. For a great action movie, Die Hard. Sometimes an actor has a hard time getting out of that shell, but he did it in such an amazing, wonderful way that it brought him into Harry Potter.
Yeah, he's going to have a hard time being known as Snape.
Correct. And you know, but that was something that he, through his career, relished. You know, he loved being that part. And, you know, for a guy like he was... Wasn't he in Sideways? He was in another wine movie.
Bottle Shock.
That's it.
Great film too.
You know, he has a great, again, somebody else who has a great library of movies under his belt. That yes, then he goes and he does Snape and he makes that character his own. I mean, it's
at a time when I don't know if they fully knew like how important Snape was going to be.
Yeah. No, the books weren't all fully written yet either. Yeah.
Yeah. And, like, Snape the character was, you know, mostly supposed to be hated. Yeah. But, yes, that's a whole different story. Yeah,
but again, the point is that he leaves a body of work. And so, mm-hmm. you know, obviously, though it may be tragic, you know, you have a collection that you can go to, unlike with most people.
Yeah, it's hard. It's hard for an actor to be known and recognized for one great role. Okay, that's hard enough. He's done it multiple times. And again, I say that about Johnny, you know, you can say the same for Johnny Depp. You know, we're talking some actors who've been in franchises and you know, some people find it hard to just step into one franchise to get lucky enough to have that happen, to have that lightning in a bottle happen. So, yeah, it was nice to see that up there on the big screen.
Yeah, but Phil, you mentioned, you know, like, big books and whatnot on sci-fi, but you know what's another book series that you should definitely
the be fifth fans wave of? Book series.
Yeah.
Hey tell guys, us about so we're lucky enough to have obviously fantastic supporters of this show, and the supporters that we choose for our show, we also try to make sure are in line with what you guys would be interested in. So our sponsor for this show is the Fifth Wave Book Series, and guess what? Let me give you guys the premise. What if today was the last normal day of your life? Cassie Sullivan thought she knew what tomorrow would bring. She was wrong. We were all wrong. The first wave took our power, killing 500,000 people. The second wave put that number to shame with tsunamis that destroyed everyone within 100 miles of the ocean. Goodbye, coastal cities. After the third wave, only the unlucky remained, survivors of a virus that left only 3% of the world still standing. In the fourth wave, the others became us, inhuman beings hiding behind human faces. At the dawn of the fifth wave, we had to choose, give up or get up and fight. But that was only the beginning. In these last days, Earth's remaining survivors will need to decide what's more important, saving ourselves or saving what makes us humans. Rick Yancey's number one New York Times best-selling novel, The Fifth Wave, introduces us to a group of young people struggling to survive in the aftermath of a catastrophic alien invasion. Its sequels, The Infinite Sea and the newly released The Last Star, follow them through a series of battles and betrayals as they fight the ultimate war between life and death, hope and despair, love and hate. Entertainment Weekly calls the series remarkable, not to be missed under any circumstances, and urges fans to just read it. USA Today hails this as a modern sci-fi masterpiece, and best-selling author of The Passage, Justin Cronin, raves in his New York Times book review, calling The Fifth Wave wildly entertaining. And the highly anticipated finale is here and will leave readers stunned. Guess what? Go to fifthwavebooks.com. Check it out. Again, that's one of our sponsors for this show. We appreciate them. We thought it'd be something cool for you. You guys like a lot of sci-fi. You guys like reading. So fifthwavebooks.com. Check it out.
I have to add to that. You know, you mentioned something. I always find that reading, I'm a huge reader. You know how much I love movies. And I always find that people who love movies like us, they also enjoy reading because it takes you out of the medium for a little bit. It's something different. Finding an exciting book or book series is amazing. But yeah, if you're a fan of movies, I'm willing to bet that 9 out of 10 that you're somewhat of an avid reader and that you read genre type. And you know, being that we're talking about a genre, Alice Through the Looking Glass.
I mean, Lewis Carroll.
Yeah, so. Go to the website. Check it out.
All right, let's talk a little bit about the directing. James Bobin, however you say his last name. I personally am not quite too familiar with his work other than the Muppets and Muppets Most Wanted films, which are a completely different type of films compared to this one. But he's worked on
A lot of comedy in the past.
Yes, a lot of comedy. He's worked on the Ali G show and whatnot. That's how he got involved with this, with Sacha Baron Cohen. But from a directing standpoint, where do you think he did a great job following the footsteps of Tim Burton?
I thought so. Obviously, Tim Burton was still a producer on this, so it's not like he didn't have necessarily a hand in it. And you can, you know, it's great. You can see the respect that he has for this. Right, he wasn't just a hired gun. It was someone who was, and the sequel wasn't, oh, we just have to get out another sequel. It's obviously a group that cared enough to want to make it, to try to make it as best as they could. And overall, I thought they succeeded, and under his direction and tutelage, I thought, again, what showed up on screen is a good result.
Yeah, I mean, I think he did a more than capable job. You know, Tim Burton said from pretty much from day one that he wasn't going to be involved in a sequel, in directing. So I think it's tough. You got to try to find somebody, you know, to continue that world from a visual standpoint. And, you know, I think Tim Burton set up the pins, for somebody and Robin to come in and try to knock him down. He built that platform. He built the sandbox. And, you know, for Bob, in interviews that I'd read, this was he jumped at the chance when he heard that it was available. And again, he's from England. I said earlier on that Lewis Carroll and these stories are very British. Like, you grow up as a kid having to read these novels, and he really wanted to jump right in. It's his biggest movie that he's done, and I really think he did a good job of doing his best. He built upon the world. We got to see new aspects of this world that was created in the Tim Burton movie. They stayed in line. They didn't break thematically from that world. So things weren't like jarring, like, oh, that doesn't belong here. Everything that was created that was new to us looked as if it belonged in this world of Alice in Wonderland. I appreciate that. He kept things going at a really good pace. He had a good crew around him. You know, he kept things as coherent as possible. I think they crafted as good a story as you can come up with without being redundant.
I think he handled the cast ensemble part. It's like the fact that he's been involved in the Muppets, right? I mean, sure. Think about what the type of skill set you have to have for something like that.
Absolutely.
It's not this, you know, I mean, these are like the Muppets of Wonderland.
Right.
In some sense, right? So, it worked out well.
What do you think?
I enjoyed it. I mean, for a storytelling aspect, and just I easily understood where everything was going. Yes, there was a lot of moving parts, literally, for this film, but I think it was done in such a way that I easily understood where everything was going. I liked how they did use the aspect of time, and it still moved forward in a comprehensible way. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah, and his action sequences I felt were really well done.
Yeah.
Storytelling, I thought he was able to convey a good story from beginning to end. Yeah, I think by handing him the reins to something, you're right. You couldn't be more different than the Muppets. And, you know, when you're dealing with a $170 million budget, as opposed to the Muppets, which I'm sure wasn't even close to that.
No. I think 40 for those.
Yeah, so
I mean, he did have the bonus feature that he's just working with really good actors.
Yeah.
That, you know, they do their part and he does his.
Right.
So I easily understood this movie, so I didn't feel like some parts were disconnected. It all felt very connected.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Let's get into the production and the editing aspect of this film. Again, this wasn't a long film, and I think it flowed very nicely to it, again, with the whole time span and the whole timetable that things were moving forward in a very rapid pace.
Right.
So it was good that it wasn't longer, because their budget would have ballooned a little bit more.
Yeah. I think it's, you're right. I mean, it, I don't know. It didn't feel long to me. I don't know what the exact runtime of this movie was, but it's...
I think an hour 40.
An hour 40?
I don't know.
It's a fairly short movie.
Yeah, and, you know, I appreciated it. It never, for me, it never overstayed its welcome. I understood where we were. I thought that it was shot. I thought it was shot very well. Cinematographer Stuart Dryberg had his hands full, but they did try to do as much location shooting as possible, which is great because 75% of this movie is done in a green screen, he did say it was one of the longest post-productions that he has had. And, you know, he's like, but as a DP, once filming is complete and picture is locked, there's not much he can do. While they edit, other than maybe coloring, which you deal with post coloring and such. I found that to be very interesting. He was also asked about, because even to this day, with digital being so relevant, so prominent in our business of making movies, there's still the debate of analog digital. And, he's like, you know, this choice, not usually mine, it's made by the directors or the producers. Some directors with enough clout will insist on film, but digital has become industry standard. I'm at home with both. I love film's great texture and process. You don't get to see the result while shooting, so you have to visualize, which is an intellectual exercise. So I love that statement because, Phil, you're very familiar. When you're filming on film, you don't get the instant playback.
You better trust yourself.
Yeah. You better hope that your DP is getting it right and that DP has to visualize. And he's like making sure there's a right filter on the lens, there's a right cover on a light, the right type of lights pointing to where they're supposed to
be. There's no hair in the gate.
Right.
The old joke.
The gate.
And, to me, what a DP has to go through today, we can fix it in post. I mean, before that was a joke, fix it in post, but that meant more budget. Mm. But now fixing it in post, you could fix it right there. you have a previs pretty much as you shoot it today. So I find that, it's an intellectual exercise. It makes shooting with film more of a mental exercise, and I can believe it.
Yeah.
I can believe that. So, but again, he's one of those guys that's like, hey, it's the world today. I need to work. So, I got to embrace it.
Yeah. And this film, ImageWorks was very involved with the VFX and whatnot. And ImageWorks had the highest number of shots to date for them, which is about 1,700 VFX shots. And if you think about it, the whole traveling through the oceans of time and then the whole chasing of when time is rusting over, that whole chasing scene wow, that was
it
so
was.
Cool to watch.
Oh my God, yeah.
To be fair, the context was Lord of the Rings is about 2.5 hours, the third one, and that had about 1,200 shots.
Yeah.
So.
That's hard to believe, too.
Yeah.
And that was already 13 years ago.
Yeah, yeah.
But
and they filmed this specifically too within the 3D world. Mm-hmm. They knew this was going to be in the 3D world. It looked fantastic. Mm-hmm. It looked fantastic. It really did.
It did. It was so pretty. And then Demetri, you mentioned that people sometimes just come for, you know, just to watch it for the visual effects. And it's like, and I that's what I liked about the first one. It was such a visual effects overload that it was really cool and that really stood out, especially in that time, even though it wasn't that long ago, but it was still fairly like brand new in that concept. And I think I liked how that one was so visually creative. Like, they still kept that in the second one.
Yeah, and again, when you really think about it, too, you talk about the first one, Tim Burton is such a visual director, right? Mm-hmm. And there are times where some of his movies, story-wise, you might go, but you'll forgive if, like, because visually, it's unlike anything you've seen before. And he's done it in dramas. He's done it in action movies, like the Batman movies he's done. Which I believe Batman Returns, I think, is the only sequel he's ever directed. I think Batman Returns could be it.
Could be.
But then he does it in comedies. Look at movies like Pee-wee's Big Adventure. You know, that has that Tim Burton visual style, which helps that. I mean, Pee-wee's Big Adventure is funny because of our character, but the visual style, like Large Marge, the eyes popping out. And then look at Beetlejuice. You know, look at the visual style in Beetlejuice. And then, you know, very visual director. He sets up an amazing platform for Bobbin to come in that's already in place. And he doesn't try to up that ante. He just tries to add to that world that's already created. Smart. It's good for him.
I liked it. Phil, what were some of your favorite visual moments?
That's always going to be... Visually, I mean, it kind of comes down to, honestly, like, some of it just comes down to the costuming, you know, for me. And, you know, and that's the real practical stuff. And it's just the combination of the colors at all times. I mean, to me, I always enjoyed the brighter scenes, right? Like being with time, everything was a little bit dark. And obviously, it's got scale to it and whatnot. But just seeing something kind of luscious in the trees and the and the different colors and the vibrancy, I gravitated more towards those, just because, again, everything had scale, but I don't know, maybe I just like sunny things.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. What were you gonna say?
I think one of my favorite shots was time when he was with the stopwatches.
Yes.
And the more particular ones were for all the ones that were still alive. Because it looked like heaven, like that type of world. Then he walks over to the ones who are dead. But like, that was such a cool shot, in contrast to what he was wearing, which was so dark and somewhat purple compared to the like the bright orangish red behind him. I think that was just a visually stunning shot that like will never leave me.
Yeah, and Phil, you talk color. We talked a little bit color of dresses. Again, although I couldn't find anything from Colleen Atwood, but her dress, Alice's dress, to be specific, the beginning of the movie when she walks into the party, okay, where everybody is all Victorian, their whites, their beiges, their blacks, and whatever, and she comes in this, I believe it was from China.
Yes.
And what I couldn't find is whether or not Colleen Atwood, like, actually researched and if that was actual type color dress that
Japanese,
would have been Japanese, my apologies.
Colleen Atwood, you know, very well renowned person for wardrobe, that she studied the 80s Japanese designs and she took special note of the structure of what they looked like. And she says herself, "We needed yards and yards of vintage looking fabrics for Alice's Chinese influence costumes." And so I guess it was Chinese. But we knew we weren't going to be able to find that anywhere. So they did vintage fabrics. And so the textile department hand-embroidered 70 yards of basic blue silk to create the look that they wanted.
Yeah, I was just, but I was curious as to whether or not the dress she was wearing came from that time. Much like all the other costumes in that scene were, you can say that's from that time. Was the dress she wearing from that time as well, but that's something that they would
maybe
wear
in
because that's what the character said. This is what they're wearing in China. I just loved how she stood out, and yet it was a beautiful dress. I didn't find it, you know, it was great. And again, it said so much about that character showing up and the looks that she was getting and such. Yes, it was good stuff.
Yeah, the costumes were always fun to watch. I mean, always. We talked about the white the White Queen and Red Queen's costumes a little bit. But yeah, Colleen Atwood. I mean, if they did a third Alice in Wonderland, and like I'd, which maybe they could write a story for that, I'd totally watch it
as well. Alice back in Wonderland.
Yeah,
back in Wonderland.
Returns to Wonderland. I would watch it, and I would hope that she did the costume for that as well.
Yeah.
A little bit of the music and soundtrack. Danny Elfman.
Long-time Tim Burton collaborator.
Yes. So many that I can't even count how many right now.
Yeah, they only had... There was a time period where they had a little bit of a falling out. They made up, you know, became best buds again. You know, it's hard to envision. It's like... It would be like Steven Spielberg not using John Williams or George Lucas not using John Williams.
Right.
Tim Burton not being able to utilize Danny Elfman of Oingo Boingo fame. You know, and he's become such an accomplished, another cinema score composer throughout the years. Yeah, it's hard, you know, he's just come such a long way.
Amazing. And he created a whole new theme for the character Time, which I liked. The moment in this film, I mean, it was prevalent throughout the whole movie, but one that really stuck out for me was when the whole Rust chasing.
Yes.
And the putting back the Chronosphere, you can definitely tell because there's really no dialogue. It was just running and just music swelling up. That's when it really stood out to me. Brilliant. Fantastic. A little bit about promotion. At D23, back in August 2015, they did promote this film. And Danny Elfman and Johnny Depp were there. And they, you know, they talked a little bit about Alice. They didn't really show any clips, but they did show, like, a lot of concept development pictures. And they mentioned that the whole cast was back for the second one. And it was just in the Disney lineup for the 2016. So even back then, back in August, it got me excited for this
one. Yeah.
So that was pretty much the only promotion early on about this film that I saw. But let's talk numbers and box office. Mm. Didn't garner as much as the first one.
Nay.
The first
about 70% lower.
Yeah.
Yes, that's, I mean,
90. It was
I mean, the first one like was over a billion, which was crazy, and then this one opened up to only 28 million.
26? Didn't even do 27.
That was the opening weekend.
Yeah. Came in at number two.
So why do you think it was solo? Because it was up against X-Men or is Memorial Day weekend?
Yeah, but X-Men didn't do that great either.
This one's, I don't know. It's very interesting because... In research that I've been reading, number one, the sequel came out, this is what, 5-6 years after the original? 6 years.
Because the first one
came out, right?
Yeah.
2010?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so something that I read that I found to be very interesting is that back in 2010, there was this resurgence, too, about 3D. Like, James Cameron proved to everybody that 3D is viable if done well and done right. Disney, when they made Alice in Wonderland, they really did hype up the 3D factor, and they took a page from the James Cameron book of 3D and said, well, if we're going to make it vibrant and pop, we have to make it good. Mm-hmm. And this is when, like, you're trying to get film audiences back. I think the marketing for the first Alice in Wonderland was spot on. It knew exactly the audience that it was going for. And remember, this is well before Disney started... like just like copying from their own animated movies. I mean, this was an animated movie brought to real, like, you know, made into a live movie. Now they've got Maleficent, they've done Cinderella, they've done the Jungle Book, they're doing Beauty and the Beast. I mean, now, you know, Alice in Wonderland pretty much started that off for them. I think marketing wise 6 years ago, I think they were very on point. They knew exactly what they were going for. They really did hype up the 3D angle a lot. And that got audiences in. I think, I don't know, this time around, I have to say, I think that the Disney marketing, I think they sort of kind of missed their mark. They made a very trippy trailer that I really enjoyed. But at the same time, I'm not sure that whatever younger audience they were going for was going to quite understand. I don't know. That's just what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
Off the top.
It's just unfortunate it didn't. I mean, the first one was huge, and also the first one was in a different time. Granted, it was only 6 years ago, but 2010 was a huge movie for 3D. I mean, if you think about it, you had, I mean, you had in the end tail end of 2009, leading into 2010, we had Avatar, and then 2010 you had How to Train Your Dragon in 3D, you had Toy Story 3 in 3D, this movie in 3D. Like, there was a lot of movies that was when 3D was becoming big again, and I think they had that going for them.
Yeah.
And now we're just in a time where, like, oh, okay, it's 3D. Do we want to go see it in 3D? Yes. No. Who knows?
And I'm not entirely sure if 5 years, you know, I'm not sure that that length, too, may have had something to play into it. We have a little bit of competition out there. Kids' movies. I know Angry Birds was, you know, it didn't fall off. It didn't fall off a cliff. You did have X-Men, but no, that's a completely different... It's a completely different audience. Mm-hmm. Memorial Day weekend, this is a big push. A lot of families are going away. I think the weather was particularly decent across the country for, you know, here and there. You know, it's sort of a head scratcher as to what it was. And again, I think the first Alice in Wonderland story is pretty much straightforward. This one is a little bit, it's grander in scope. It's a little bit bigger. It's very ambitious. And I think, like, you know, to criticize a movie for being overly ambitious is like an oxymoron. I mean, like, we want movies to be overly ambitious, but I maybe that the audience, the girl, maybe they didn't connect as much as they did with Alice. Now, CinemaScore, this movie gets an A-.
Yeah.
Yeah. It didn't make no sense.
And, you know, it, again, it doesn't make sense.
IMDb 6.5.
Yeah, and Rotten Tomatoes, again, it's at 30%. It's very low. It's much lower than what I think the even...
It doesn't deserve a 29% on Rotten Tomatoes.
No, I agree. I completely agree. Again, I'm wondering, what movie are they watching? Like, did they see something else at a press screening that like completely tainted this movie and made it a really bad movie? Because this doesn't look like a 30% movie to me. You know,
it wasn't.
No. And A minus, somebody liked the movie. And A minus usually would suggest some like a leveling off. You're not going to have that much of a drop. But we'll see. We'll see what happens this, to my knowledge. Well, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles is what they're going to be going up against.
Yeah.
And thus far, that one looks to be doing some...
Again, a different demographic, too.
True. We'll see what happens. You know, but it's just very interesting, like, how things have changed and marketing has changed. I know Disney probably wanted more. They may have wanted even one more movie. I'm not even sure we're going to get that. Although, you do have to take a look, though. All right, so it was, what do we say, $170 million? Okay, so close to $200 million. This is, like, all in budget-wise. Now, foreign, like, they did $69 million. Thus far. So worldwide gross, we're looking at over $104, $105 million worldwide. You know, that's not too shabby. I mean, the foreign markets seem to be doing much better than here in the States.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see what holding power they have going into its second weekend. That'll determine whether or not we get a sequel, I think.
Yeah. Overall, it was a fun movie, I think. I definitely think this movie has a rewatchable factor to it.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I would definitely see this movie again. I may even buy it.
Yeah, I think there's a rewatchability.
I'm also just a Disney fan. But I think this one was such a fun film to follow.
Yeah.
And I like the characters, and I love Disney, obviously. But this was a fun movie that you can easily rewatch over and over again.
Yeah, it was an enjoyable movie. Much more enjoyable than I thought it was going to be.
Yeah. All right. So last thoughts, Phil.
You know, it's interesting that this movie's been compared to The Huntsman: Winter's War, which it was a sequel that also didn't do well and things like that. I mean, Demetri had mentioned earlier that people just like comparisons.
Mm-hmm.
I think people just need that as a way to explain certain things. If that's why this movie didn't do well, okay, then great. I don't know what the full correlation there is.
Yeah, but, I don't know what that would be either.
But you know, I would say if there's people, you know, go see it with them. I mean,
Because one thing to, if you buy the Blu-ray and you have a big enough screen like that, that's one thing. But I think something like this, you know, there are movies that just benefit from the big screen. And this is one of those movies.
Absolutely. It's not going to jump off. It's not going to jump off of your television screen. And listen, hey, if you are that person who has an actual type of screening room, okay. Watch maybe you will. You know, I don't. And though I take pride in my home theater system, it still wouldn't jump off the screen as it did when I saw it in the theaters, where it really looked gorgeous and beautiful. You want those colors to pop cinematography-wise, 3D-wise. You want it to work, not be blurry, don't get sick, but you want to be drawn in. This is definitely not as bad a movie as a lot of the critics would portray it to be. Like, no. I think that if you took your daughters, you'd have a good time. I don't think you'd roll your eyes.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I really enjoyed this film. I probably will buy this when this comes out on DVD. Overall, I think it was a really strong sequel. And usually a lot of people's like sequels don't do as well. Maybe they don't do as well in numbers and whatnot, in the technical aspects. But overall, as a film, this was very solid on all fronts. And that's what I appreciated with this film.
Yeah.
So thank you, everyone, for listening and tuning in. So where can everyone keep following you, Demetri?
Well, folks, you can please support me on Twitter. I'm at DMovies1701, at DMovies1701. I appreciate comments. I appreciate you supporting me on Twitter. I always like to go on and check out movie news, and I tweet stuff about movies, so hopefully you'll find that fun and interesting. So at DMovies1701.
And Phil...
follow us here at The Popcorn Talk. Check out all of our other shows, whether here on Anatomy of Movie. We've done so many. You don't always have to, you know, as you see movies, check back in with us. We've probably covered it. If you're finally catching up to certain movies, go back in our repertoire and listen. You know, that's the great thing. It's whenever you want. It's whatever movie you want. So we've got a lot of movies that we've covered. And, hey, that's just Anatomy of Movie. On Popcorn Talk, we have a ton of great movies.
Disney Movie News.
Fly, what is it called? I keep calling it fly fishing film.
On the fly filmmaking.
There you go.
Fly fishing film. Isn't on the fly that filmmaking. Salmon at the Yemen.
We just started a great new show called
On the Fly Filmmaking, all about guerrilla filmmaking styles film. We have a lot of films, Marvel movie news, Disney, if you guys are into that, which I'm sure you are because you watched this film.
Guilty Movie Pleasures.
Star Wars, and we have
Jedi Alliance.
Jedi Alliance.
More anatomies in the future. We'll be doing other Disney films like Finding Dory, so excited. We'll be doing Beauty and the Beast when that comes out next year. So
saw the trailer for Finding Dory on this.
Yes, yeah, pretty that cool. We did. Yeah. I'm very excited. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in. And you know what? Read the Alice in Wonderland books. They're fantastic. And then also read The Last Star. So thanks, everyone, and we'll see you for our next dissection.
Phil Svitek and the rest of the Anatomy of a Movie staff, we would like to thank you for listening and subscribing to the show. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to email or tweet us. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been Anatomy of a Movie.